the Goodwill, but I did buy a banana hanging gadget the other day. So I don't know if it should count against me. We are using it to hang bananas, but it's not just sitting there. So I don't think it should, but on the other hand, it is like a gadget for hanging bananas. So say it again.
Does it keep them fresher?
Does it keep them fresher? Yes. Yes, it does. Yeah. Oh, all right. You have experience with that. Okay. Well, see, it really works. Okay. Well, then hopefully that... It's effective, it's in use. It's a piece of plastic, though. All right, well, I'm keeping my fingers crossed. Okay, let's have a prayer. Loving and gracious God, you walk with us on life's journey. Open our eyes to see the guiding stars that lead us to you. Open our hearts to feel and respond with gratitude. Help us find a new way when it's needed. Amen. So I can understand why the early Christians... Is something beeping? Oh, okay. Thanks. I can understand why the early Christians who remembered and retold Jesus' story would remember and retell this one about the wise men coming from the east to give honor to Jesus. For the community whose stories were written in the Gospel of Matthew, it was very important to them to point out, first of all the ways that Jesus was predicted by and is in continuity with the Hebrew Scriptures, also known as the Old Testament to us. So in today's passage, we hear that when the wise men can't find the new king in Jerusalem, they look to the Scriptures, and surprise, it's Bethlehem where the Messiah is to be born. The wise men also connect Jesus to the wider human world, because they are from the east, they're from a totally different country, and to all of creation, by showing that a guiding star appeared to guide them, travelers from far away, to where he was. Jesus' birth means something not just to the Jews, but to all people everywhere, and to the entire created world, all that from one little story in Matthew. But what I have a harder time understanding or thinking about from this perspective is why would these wise men, or as Eugene Peterson translates it in the Message, these scholars, want to go on a long and dangerous journey just to see a little baby and give it gifts? And is it a political motivation? Are they hoping to get on his good side? What is their motivation? So I'm imagining the scholars as being a little bit geeky. They're fanatics. Later tradition turns them into kings, right? We hear we three kings. But in the Bible story, there's no mention of them being kings. They're astronomers, they are astrologers, learning about what's happening on the earth by watching the sky. And one day something so unusual happens that they have to find out what it means. They have to follow it to the source. They have to find out what the star in the west is guiding them to. So imagine someone who likes to birdwatch, a birder, if you will. Perhaps you know one. Does anyone know a birder? Is anyone a birder here? Do we have any birders? Okay. And one day the birder is out in the woods, you know, looking at birds. And in the midst of all the usual sounds and somewhat less usual sounds, perhaps, he hears a call he's never heard before. But from the guidebook, he thinks it might be a bird that was supposed to be extinct. He follows the sound of the call, listening with excitement and anticipation and passion. And it's thrilling, of course, although if you were out there tagging along with him, it would probably help you put up with getting branches smacked in your face if, as you follow the call, you happen to already be a birder, right? It helps to have a similar passion. Oh, I know. I'm sorry. We're going to have to start the sermon over. We're recording it so you can listen to it later online, right? Or maybe not. We'll figure it out. So anyway, imagine the birder running off after the extinct bird, right? This is so exciting. And there's a few branches smacked in their face for the three wise men as well, as they're trying to follow that star to the new Messiah of Israel. It might be considered a natural mistake, but they figure that since the star is guiding them to the country of Israel, that the next ruler born there will probably be born in the capital, the son of the current ruler maybe, or at least one of his near relatives, which is what everybody in Jerusalem thinks too. And that's why they're all freaked out when the astronomers arrive, walk up to the palace gate, and ask for an audience. Congratulations, they say, we're here to see the new baby. Where is he? Right, you know, if somebody came to your house and said, oh, I'm excited to see your new baby, you might be a little bit nervous, right? They are so close to the elusive bird's habitat. Now they'll have a chance to pay their respects and to see this wonderful specimen. But it's a disappointment for them. The baby isn't in Jerusalem. The baby isn't in the seat of power. The child that is so important that he changes the very created order, these people don't even know about. They're running the country, but they don't know about the most important thing to happen there ever. They have to have a big conference, talk to their scholars, find out what the historical record is, and send the astronomers on. I wonder what the people in Jerusalem are thinking when the scholars leave. We know what Herod is thinking. He's thinking destroy. Later in the chapter, he sends people out to try to kill this baby who might somehow disrupt his power. The scholars, on the other hand, continue on their journey and find Jesus there with his mom living in the village of Bethlehem. They look pretty ordinary to a non-specialist, but to these scholars, the star overhead tells the story. They're so excited to see the baby. They kneel down and worship in awe of this child who, in one sense, is exactly what he appears to be, a boy like any other, and who, in another sense, at the same time, as they look at him, is the creating God of the universe. Good luck nipping that kind of power and majesty in the bud, Herod. The truth is that Herod is operating on a totally different level than Jesus. He's worried about local politics, rebellion, control, governance, and administration. He's trying to shoot a spitball at Mount Rushmore. And I think if you're the tourist spot, it would be difficult. Maybe if you're closer, but anyway. And it seems like at first the scholars were also looking to meet Jesus, the local king, or possibly Jesus, the regional emperor, but a king in the political time-limited sense, nonetheless. So they go to Jerusalem, they cooperate with Herod, they plan to do what he asks. But meeting Jesus gives them the strength and the wisdom to return home by a different way. After meeting Jesus, after the joy of discovering him in an unexpected place, after finding and worshiping him and giving him gifts of gratitude, they leave transformed. Their first loyalty isn't to the regular center of power in Jerusalem. It's not to the high priests collecting prestige and extending Herod's hand. What they're warned about, when they're warned to reject Herod, they do. They go home by a different way. So what does this mean for us today? As we travel our life journey, we should probably expect the unexpected and try to find Jesus in Bethlehem, not Jerusalem. The centers of power, the people who seem to have it all, maybe even the centers of religious power. It's very unlikely that we'll find Jesus there. Not that he's not there, but being able to see him through the mist is very difficult. Instead, we can look for Jesus in Bethlehem. In the little town that people don't really go to unless they have to. In the people who have struggled so much in their lives just to barely scrape by. In the simple rush of water over stones in a little creek by the side of the road. The kingdom of God is not like the kingdom of Herod. It's not something that needs to be defended or that Herod could have defended himself against. Instead, the kingdom of God is like a long journey that brought us where we didn't expect to go, showed us something about life and God that we didn't expect to see, and changed us so much that we went home by a different way. Thanks be to God. Amen. So let's have some time for silent reflection, and then we'll do the sermon again. We'll have just half the sermon, that's right. We'll have a community conversation. Let's pray.